crazy. It's indescribable.
To watch that child open that box for the very first time and see the look on their faces, it's amazing that God used a simple shoebox to bring that much joy.
This is amazing. As you can see, the children's faces, they are excited as they open up the gifts for the first time.
What makes the gifts more than just gifts is the message that comes with the gift.
This is the opportunity for a child to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ.
That is the best gift of all, is becoming part of God's family.
Thank you. We are very happy. God bless you. Yay!
These people back behind us, they're giving their time. Families have given boxes. The enthusiasm, the excitement, it's off the charts. We're just so thankful for these volunteers. We couldn't do it without them.
They are the heart of the ministry. And because of them, many children, like even me, accept Jesus as the Lord and Savior.
What children need more than anything is love, hope, and faith in God. Every shoebox gift is an opportunity to share your faith.
We thank you for this ministry that is yours, that you use a shoebox gift to go around the world to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
It starts with a simple shoebox gift, and from there, these gifts go around the world and are given to each child. It could be in a pickup truck, it could be the top of a bus, the roof of a taxi, camels and donkeys, canoes going up the river, whatever it takes to get these gifts into the hands of children. And that's only the beginning.
After children receive the box, they get to go through a 12-lesson discipleship course. And these children, they're committing their lives to Christ. And they get to share their faith with other children.
After a child completes the greatest journey, they graduate and receive a certificate and a Bible in their own language.
My name is Romina Alejandra. I really like to draw and cook. One day, I was drawing and I wanted some markers. And I asked my mother if she could buy them for me. She said no, because she didn't have the money. Today, we received gift boxes. When I opened the box and saw the markers, I was very excited. I learned about God through the box. Today, I prayed that Jesus would come into my heart. I am very grateful to everyone, to God, and to you all for bringing me this box.
This box provides the opportunity to put a smile on a child's face, gets them to know more about Jesus Christ, and also be disciples so that they can be disciple makers in the world.
They're trained and equipped to go out and share their faith with others, and many times in areas where it's an unreached people group. The Bible tells us the time is now.
We have seen churches being planted. We have seen people being transformed.
The mission of Operation Christmas Child never changes. Children are coming to Jesus, and children are taking the gospel to the ends of the earth.
This is incredible. Millions of children around the world are being impacted by these simple shoebox gifts. One box can touch not just the child, but the whole family. So we need to keep packing those boxes and pray for the children that God will use this in a very special way. So thank you for being a part of it. God bless you.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good. Welcome back to church. It's great to see all your faces. If you didn't notice on your way in, there is a table set up with these little communion cups. So if you're with us today and you didn't grab one, feel free to duck out into the foyer and get one before we get rolling with communion a little later this morning. If you're watching online, we are going to be doing communion today, so feel free to get up, grab some bread and some juice or crackers and coffee, whatever you've got, because we will be taking part in communion together later on this morning. So if you've got your bulletins, pull them out, open them up. If you take notes on your phone, pull your phone out, open it up. We're going to run through some events happening over the next week or so, just so that we're all on the same page. Because as always, there's a lot going on in our community and you don't want to miss anything. So Tonight at 7 p.m., there's youth in the lower level, so if you or someone you know is a teen from grade 7 to grade 12, so that's 12 years old up to 18, 19 years old, send them my way. We meet in the lower level of the church every Sunday night at 7. So if you have any questions about that, grab me anytime. Monday night, so tomorrow night is Halloween. I don't know if you guys knew that. I don't know if you noticed all the candy that's been in the stores for the last month or so, but we are doing trunk or treat at the church again tomorrow evening. So we're starting at 6 p.m. If you are one of the very kind and excited brave souls that's coming to decorate your trunk to hand out candy with us, get here whenever you can. We'll get you set up, get you your spot, prime parking, so that we can enjoy some time with the families in our neighborhoods together. If you didn't sign up beforehand and you're thinking, man, I really wish I did, I'd like to come join Trunk or Treat, no fear, you can still join us. We'd love to have you. So if you're not handing out candy, but you're bringing a little one to come get candy, stop here first. We're starting at 6 and we're going until the candy's gone. So that didn't take long last year, so please make this a priority. We would love to see you and your little ones or older ones all dressed up. If you have any questions about that, ask any one of us. Tuesday nights at 7, there is life group happening at Terry and Sandy Stone's house, so they are going through the Book of John together. If you haven't been there yet and you would like to, I think you can still join. Yep. So the more the merrier, a great opportunity to go fellowship and talk about God's word together. We did have a loss in our community this week, so many of you know by now that Jonathan Thompson did pass away, so his service will be this Wednesday at the church at 2 p.m. All are welcome to come and enjoy and celebrate his life together with friends and family, so that's this Wednesday at 2 here at the church. If you have any questions about that, let us know. And then moving on down to the bottom of your page there in the FYI section, there's just three things I kind of want to hit on so that we don't miss anything again. November 7th is our next Taste of Home community supper. So there's a sign-up sheet out in the lobby for supplies needed for that. So those have been a big hit and a great opportunity to break bread together as just a community of people looking to connect again. So if you haven't made it out before, we encourage you to do so. It's a great time to connect with one another and connect with people outside of our church family and really welcome them in. Something special happens around the supper table, so don't miss out on that opportunity if you haven't had a chance to partake already. And these next two ones are some of my favorite announcements because they are Christmas related. So who's ready for Christmas? All right, I see a little bit of excitement. Okay. If you haven't started listening to the Christmas music yet, I would say you're a little behind schedule there. That's just me, but you do you. So if you noticed on your way in, we do have a little stand set up with some of the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. So the video that we watched at the beginning today about Operation Christmas Child and just the shoebox ministry was to kind of tee us up for that ministry again this year. So our church has been a part of this for many, many years, and we're rolling with it again this year because it's a great opportunity to pack a shoebox and send a child some love. And for these kids, most of them, it's the first and in some cases only Christmas present or present of any sort they ever receive. And you're not just giving them a gift of some toys that they'll play with for a year or so and then it gets forgotten. Part of the ministry is that they are given the opportunity to partake in that class where they're presented with the gospel, they're given a chance to ask questions, and they're really ministered to in a fulfilling way, and it's a great opportunity to spread the gospel to the ends of the earth. So it's time to pack a shoebox again. So we've got a few out in the foyer there. You'll notice that there aren't many. So what we would encourage you to do is to do your shoebox shopping this week, come back next Sunday and pick up as many boxes as you need, and we will have endless quantities of them for you. So they are due back at the church here by November 13th, so that's why I say do your shopping this week, pick up your box next week, and then you'll have another week to get it packed and bring it back to us. So if you have any questions about that or any concerns, again, just grab one of us and we will either get you the answers or point you in the right direction to find them. And last announcement here, it's the last one on your page there, December 23rd is our Christmas Eve gathering, and that will be at 7 p.m. here at the church. So more to come on that, but just to kind of get you in the holiday spirit. If you're a little slow to get into the Christmas mood, we're getting you there together. Break out the Christmas sweaters, the whole nine yards. I'm already drinking my eggnog, so I'm there and I'm bringing you along with me. So that's pretty much it. The only thing I'll say, this is just a little housekeeping thing, because I would forget to do this if somebody didn't remind me. Next Sunday, just remember to set your clock back an hour. If not, you will be an hour early for church, which nothing wrong with that. You can come pray over everything for us, put the coffee on, but we won't be here until an hour after you, if that's the case. So that's all I've got for announcements this morning. But again, if you have questions about anything that was mentioned this morning, just pull me aside after and I'll either give you the information or get it for you. So we are going to read some scripture again this morning, and we are reading in Luke 22. So if you'd all like to read with me, why don't we all stand this morning? So starting in verse 14, we're going to read together. When the hour came, he reclined at the table and the apostles with him. Then he said to them, I have fervently desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, Take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you, from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to them, and said, This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.
Let's pray. Father God, this morning as we take communion together, we just pray that you would bless our time together. We would use this as a time to examine our hearts and our lives before you. We thank you that we are able to do this. We pray that we would not become it would not become such a routine and a habit that we would forget the significance of the incredible cost that was paid, that we are able to celebrate what communion means, Father, that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for us, to forgive us from our sins. And God, not just to give us life everlasting that we get to enjoy heaven with you someday, but Father, so that we could experience life more abundantly in the here and now. And so, God, as we take together this morning, I pray that you would speak to hearts and minds, and your Holy Spirit would be felt in this place. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. You may be seated. I would invite you to take your cup that you have, and we're all going to take together. But on the night that Jesus was betrayed, as you've heard me say many times before, this was the first communion, the first time that the disciples really celebrated in this kind of way. It was the Passover, which they would have celebrated every single year. But this would be different because it would be Christ's Last Supper with them. And the next time that they would take part and receive this gift, it would be in celebrating a new gift that they had, and that was eternal life, that no longer did they have to do the things that the old covenant required them to do. And I think we forget sometimes the sacrifice that went into this. And so as Jesus lifted the loaf of bread and he broke it, he said, let us give thanks and let's feed on him, meaning Jesus Christ, with faith and thanksgiving. And so today as we celebrate this once again, we're reminded that this is our bread of life, that Jesus is the one that we are to lean on and to trust. And I don't know about you, but I have a hard time. I have trust issues. I've shared that before. I want to trust in myself and in my abilities. And I was reminded just here in the last 24 hours how incredibly much life can change. And without going into a lot of details, you can be praying for this situation. I have a good friend from high school whose son was tragically hurt in a car accident this week and was on a full basketball scholarship, had his life in front of him, and will now live a quadriplegic And as I was exchanging some text with Trish last night, heartbroken, she said these words, "But God is faithful." And it's a reminder to me that we might think we have life under control, but we don't, do we? We just never know what tomorrow holds, but God does. And He's invited us to put our faith and our trust in Him and feed on Him, the author and perfecter of our faith. And so with thanksgiving, let us take this together, remembering that Jesus is our bread of life. He is the one that we are to put our faith and our trust in Him. So all you that are here this morning and you that are watching online, let us receive this gift and be thankful this morning. And also on that same night, He lifted the cup of wine and He said, "This represents not only blood that needed to be shed for the redemption of sins, but would represent His blood in just a few hours." And so with that blood that was shed, that was the cost of our salvation. That was the cost not only of us enjoying heaven with Him one day, but the cost of having the gift of His Holy Spirit here in our everyday life. The disciples did not know what that was. They had experienced having Jesus with them, but if Jesus wasn't with them on a particular day, that His presence wasn't there. But then when the Holy Spirit came, that we can experience Jesus with us every single day and every moment, and what a gift that is. But it came at a cost, and the cost was His blood and His death. And so as we receive this gift this morning, let us be reminded that Christ's blood was shed for us and be thankful.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before You this morning, humbled as we sit in remembrance of the sacrifice that You made for us. Lord, thank You for having a plan and a purpose for each and every life, and for making a way for us to be reunited with You. Jesus, thank You for coming down to this world to live a perfect life in the midst of chaos, to offer Yourself up as a sacrifice for our sins. And on the eve of being taken, on the eve of being put through one of the most horrendous deaths for our sake, thank You for thinking to pray for us. Lord, thank You for the gift of salvation being freely offered to any that would call on Your name. Lord, let us not grow weary in doing well in Your name. Let us continually come back to the cross and be reminded of what a gift it is to be called Your children, to be called Your friends, and to be covered by Your blood. Lord, thank You for the gift of this fellowship with You and with one another. I pray that You would continually humble our hearts and stir up a spirit of gratefulness and thankfulness for the fact that we are hidden behind You, Lord, now and forever. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Morning, everyone. We're going to, this is like the fifth Sunday of the month, so we're doing seven. We'll see what we
Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by thy power of grace divine. Let my soul look out with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious
shy this morning. Amazing Grace. That should be an easy one for them to find. Anybody else got a second one they can be looking up while we're finding that one? Yeah, they'll. There is a river. Yeah, that's one we're used to. There is a river. Did you get that, Sean? I keep forgetting we've got a sound tech back there that's got to find words if he can. Tomorrow, is that what it's called, Terry, do you think?
I don't know about tomorrow. I'm not sure what the title of it is. Yeah.
Okay. We'll give Wanda a minute.
Wanda needs somebody up there along
the yeah.
way to find all the songs for you.
Here is a the other one first. No.
I know who holds tomorrow.
Yes. You're able to find Beulah Land, or? Yep. That's not the one.
The first verse starts, I've reached the land of corn and wine.
Oh,
okay.
Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land, that one, right?
Yeah, it might be.
They sing it. Brown's Flat every year. Used to anyway.
I don't know what we'd call it, something different. Okay. Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land.
I've reached my end.
To get words though, so maybe we could.
We might. No, we wouldn't know about it.
No, we could do a verse and chorus of Old Rugged Cross while he's looking for that. We know that without the words, I think. A verse and a chorus of the Old Rugged Cross while we're waiting. We can do that without the words.
The verses up, you might not have knew. So.
You what? Must be as old as Terry, I know. He should have knew that. Anybody else got any?
But if you didn't know it, maybe I had it right. No, I didn't have it right.
The Comforter has come. The Comforter has come.
Maybe Charlene, just while we're waiting, it's a good opportunity. We have somebody visiting with us today, and it is her very first time ever at the Havelock Wesleyan Church. So we just want to welcome little Ella Bauer with us today. If you have a chance to say hi to Leah and Tony, they have Ella with her this morning. So welcome little Ella.
Proclaim the joyful sound.
We've got one here that Lori had picked out earlier that I think we're going to do a verse and a chorus of God Leads Us Along. And it's been a long time since we sang that too, but I don't know if he wants to share. It was.
I was just going to say, my grandfather, when he was alive, I go to church with him, and this is one of his favorite songs. And you could hear him all over the church, so if I get carried away on this one, just let me go.
In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the waters cool flow makes the weary ones feet, God leads his dear children.
This world is not my home. We should know that with at words, maybe.
Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. I'm game.
Yeah.
Yeah. Totally.
That works year round. Joy to the world.
Able to find that, or if not, maybe Terry can. Not finding it, Terry can play with the guitar then, probably. We'll do a verse and a chorus of that. Whatever you think.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home.
Let's stand for this, yeah. We'll start the Christmas season off.
Mm-hmm. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. No more let sin and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make His blessings flow, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found, far as
singing. You may be seated.
Thank you, team. The kids are dismissed to go downstairs. I almost went right off the stage, face forward. That'd be fun, right? Right this way. There you go. I scared her. I have that effect sometimes. Usually pulling the songs up like that isn't a big deal, but the internet decided to give us some issues that we were kind of scrambling, but it all worked out. Thank you for that. We always hear back after the Sundays where we do the favorites, and that it's a positive Sunday, and because everybody gets a chance to kind of, it's the nostalgia, right, of when that song was sung and what it means to us and all of those different kind of things. And God uses those moments. I want to dig into our scripture this morning from Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, just a couple of verses, three verses actually from Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 to 30. You know, God is interested in making a whole family of people like Jesus. His purpose and His design when He spun the world into motion was to have people that were like Him. And then Adam and Eve mess it all up. And just before we're too critical on Adam and Eve, I think if Adam and Eve had been Sean and whoever, we would have messed it up too, right? It was a matter, they get the blame because they were the first, but that old sin nature kicked in. But God's purpose is that He chose us and then He changed us. I want you to hear that in that order. He chose us and then He changes us. You see, sometimes we think He changes us and then He'll choose me. You understand the difference? Like if I can whip myself into shape, because that's what our culture teaches us, right? About acceptance, and that's acceptable, that's not acceptable, this is okay, this is not okay. And God doesn't do that. He chooses us, especially if they're not a follower of Jesus. We don't have in our own strength and ability to be the person that God has called us to be. Only God can do that, and that can only happen when we surrender our lives to Him. And so we don't have a lot of people in our culture and in our world doing things that are wrong. Well, we might, but we have a lot of people in our world that need Jesus. And so what's Romans 8, chapter 28, verse 30? This can be a kind of a dangerous passage of scripture. If you've been around the church for any length of time for a Wesleyan to preach on, we're going to dive into it today. Romans chapter 28, beginning to read at verse 28. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For he foreknew, or some of your translations might say, for he predestined. He also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. We get tripped up in these verses sometimes, I think. I have before. Especially in that opening verse. And we know that all things, it doesn't say some things, it doesn't say most things, it doesn't say many things, but we know that all things work together for his glory and for his honor. As I was sharing that story during communion, I was thinking about where I was going to be preaching from today, and part of me was going, God, how are you working all things out in Stefan's life right now as he lies in a hospital bed in Ohio? God, how are you working this out? But the Bible says this, all things do. You remember the four spiritual laws? They've been around for a long time. I assume we've heard the Billy Graham Association. They were part of coming up with the four spiritual laws. Law number one, I'm not going to go through all of the laws, but law number one was this. God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. That was the introductory statement that Billy Graham and his team came up with in their evangelistic approach, and I think it's a good one. That ought to be our beginning statement when we come across anybody as hard and as tough, and we're wondering how this situation, or we're wondering about the choices that they're making and why they're making the choices. Law number one, God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life, even if you're not living it right now. You know, every day, in every way, we have a choice whether or not we're going to step into God's plan or we're going to try out our own plans. And in this passage of Scripture, we're going to see and discover what God's incredible plan is for us. There's three verses here, and I want us to notice three big ideas, three big things this morning. And the first thing is this, God's promise. Now, this promise only applies to those who love God. So I want to be really, really clear. And this isn't because we don't love those who don't love God, but this is a promise that's available to all of those who love God. And the promise is this, for those of you that are watching today, for those of you that are here that have never stepped into a relationship with Jesus, this promise doesn't apply to you. See, there's always this idea that we want all the promises of God, but we don't want the relationship or the commitment portion. We're like that in life, don't we? We want to know the minimum standard of what we can do to get whatever we need to get. We want the benefits of things without paying the cost. And it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way in life, and it certainly doesn't work that way. And so there is a cost of receiving God's promise, and that's a commitment of life to him. And so this promise only applies to those that are following Jesus. Can you honestly say that you have a deep and abiding and a passionate love for God? See, notice I didn't say, if you are a Christian. Because that word and that term means so many different things in our world today. But broken down, what it's supposed to mean is that you love God and love others. Jesus said, if you are my disciple, you will love me and you will love others as yourself. So if we're doing that, we're a follower of Jesus. Sometimes we might give an impersonal answer. Well, I'm a Wesleyan, or I'm Protestant, or I go to Mass, or I give money to the church, or I do good things, or I serve food to the hungry, or I do whatever the response may be. But let me be really direct this morning. Do you love God? Which means you love others as you want God to love you. Oh, we don't like that part. Like, why didn't you just stop, Jesus, at love God? Because he knew how we worked. Number two this morning, we see God's purpose. We see God's purpose. In verse 29, we see God's purpose. I want us to look at two words in verse 29. First of all, look at the word foreknew, for those that God foreknew. Then the second word I'd like us to look at is this word predestined that sometimes we get all bent up over. But what that means, that's God's purpose for us. First of all, he chooses us. That's what I want us to see this morning. He chooses us. He chose you. I know we make a lot out of it sometimes that we choose Jesus. And I suppose we're making the choice to be recipients of the choice that he's made for us. But initially, he chose us. God chooses me and he chooses you. Before God ever created planet Earth, millions of centuries before you and I were even conceived, God knew you, God knew me, and he chose me to be part of his family. That was his plan. I'm choosing you. God's will isn't just automatically done, and everything that happens is not in the span of God's will, but he allows some things to happen, doesn't he? But his will is that he chooses us and that we would be recipients of that choice. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says, "The Lord does not delay in keeping his promise, as some understand delay, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all come to repentance." Can I share a pet peeve with you today? I suppose it doesn't matter if you give permission. I'm going to share it anyways. It bothers me just a little bit. Actually, it bothers me a whole lot. When I hear people say, "Come, Lord Jesus, come quickly." Because I go, no. God is being patient because he doesn't want any to perish. I don't know about you. Maybe you don't have anybody else in your life that needs Jesus. But I do. And sometimes that can be, in my selfishness, I can wish that. Like, God, things are just really too hard for now, right now. So just get me out of this place. That's a selfish prayer. That wasn't the prayer of the disciples. It certainly wasn't the prayer of Jesus. Because he has a plan. But not only does he choose us, and so that's your fill in the blank there. God chooses us. Another fill in the blank for you. God changes us. He chooses us and then he changes us. Not only does he choose us, but he wants to make us into who he has envisioned us to become. In other words, he wants to make us into something different than we started out. That's the word predestined. The word predestined in verse 29, and not to give a Greek lesson this morning, comes from the word pro horizo. You recognize a bit of that word? It comes where we get our word horizon. We get our English word from that. What is the horizon? The horizon is the limit between the sky and the earth. And the Bible says God has already predetermined the limit of our existence of what he wants us to be. It's predestined. He has a plan for us. I used to love this show. Back in, I think it was in the 80s. Probably some of you watched it too. It's called The A-Team. And Hannibal used to have this statement, "I love it when a plan comes together." And he would say that in every episode. He'd come up with some crazy plans of what they were going to do to accomplish the mission that was before them. And they would kind of joke with him and say, "Yeah, he's got a plan. I don't know how it's going to work." And I think sometimes we look at God and say, "Yeah, you got a plan. I don't know how it's going to work." But God loves it when a plan comes together. But the thing is, we don't get to experience that plan if we don't step into a relationship with him. Sometimes we get all hung up over this idea of predestination. It just means God has predetermined what he wants us to look like and what we can look like. If we choose to follow him, when we came to Christ, he started the process and keeps working on us. Philippians chapter 1 verse 6 says this, "I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it out to completion until the day that Jesus comes." God doesn't leave us here any longer than what he wants to, and doesn't take us out of this world any earlier than what we needed to be taken out. He completes the work. In other words, even though our body is wasting away, he's got a plan for us. The main reason God saved you was not to take you to heaven to be with him. If that's the main purpose, the moment we gave our heart to Jesus, he would have taken us out of this world, right? If the main purpose is with a relationship with Jesus is so that we can spend eternity with him, he's a pretty mean God to leave us here after we make that commitment. That's not all there is. So why does God save us? Well, he saved us to forgive us from our sins. No, that's not the reason why he saves us either. It's part of what he does. That is the prerequisite and the benefit of salvation. But the reason God saved you and he saved me is because he wants to make us like Jesus more and more every single day. That's why he saves us. Now I want to ask you another question. How much like Jesus are you right now? You say, well, I try. I'm thankful that the Bible actually gives us an indication of what that's supposed to look like. Have you ever read Galatians chapter 5 before? The fruits of the Spirit. You see, God wants to give us those things. And the Bible says in Galatians chapter 5, but the fruit of the Spirit is, well, look at the one he gives first. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That is God's predestined plan for us to make us more like him every single day. God is interested in making a whole family of people like Jesus. And God is trying to make you and I more like him every single day. So the third big idea is God's process. How does he do it? So here's his plan. This is what he wants. This is what he wants us to look like. God's purpose is found in God calling us. First of all, it says God calls us, those he predestined, he called, that he has a plan for us. Now, this idea of predestination sounds like, oh, God forces himself on you. Well, no, he doesn't do that. He has given us all the choice to do certain things or not certain to do things. He will never violate our free will. We're given a choice about the call of Jesus Christ. God won't force his call on any of us. He loves us, and he wants us to love him in return. Nobody likes to be forced to do anything. It would go against the nature of God for him to force that on us. God wants us to trust him and to put our faith and our trust in him because it's our decision. So what about God's call? He's calling you and I today. I want to give us some ideas about what God's call is quickly, what that looks like. Jesus says, come to me. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. This is the call of salvation. So come to me as part of God's call to us. But not only does he say, come to me, we're pretty good at that. We understand that come to me and I need to surrender my life. But then he gives us some other things that we need to do too, which is the next fill in the blank there, is follow me. Mark chapter 1 verse 7 says, follow me, Jesus told them, and I will make you fish for people. What that means is some have answered the call to be to come to him, but not the answer to follow him. You see the difference? You see, if we just come to him and we do nothing else, we're missing what he's actually called us to do and to follow him and to go out and to serve. We are missing the big portion of what it means to be a follower of Jesus if we're not following him in some kind of ministry. You've not really followed him in service if you're not doing something for the kingdom of Christ. And that is not an exclusionary call. We have an opportunity. I told Catherine, we're going to hit pause here for a moment. So we've been talking a lot about this taste of home. Why do we do this taste of home? Because we believe it's really, really important to serve in tangible ways, to serve our... So it's been a wonderful success. So we need some people to follow Jesus and serve for our taste for home. And it's not complicated. We need four people that will simply show up and be welcoming and serve some tables, help with cleanup, to be the serving people that Jesus has called us to be followers of Him. You see, it's not a, this isn't an add-on thing to salvation. It's all-encompassing. And so I'm giving us a practical way that we can do that to serve our community and serve our church. And then we need some folks just to show up for supper and sit down with our community. Because this is our community. This is our place. And it's not by accident that Jesus says, follow me. Do the things that I did. And Jesus served so effectively. So if you're one of those four people, let Catherine or Michelle or I know after. Number three, abide in me, abide in him. John chapter 15, verse 4 says, abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. That means you surrender to the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. There are some that we can say sometimes, yes, I've given my heart to Jesus and I'm serving, but you're trying to do it on your own strength. And when we surrender to the power of the Holy Spirit, something incredible happens. When we're abiding in Him. When we hear things and I say things like this, I don't have the strength to continue. No, you don't. And I don't either. But I do through Christ if I'm abiding in Him. And I think many times in this culture right now of being maxed out on everything, maxed out with our time and our resources and all of those things, it's because we've been abiding in me and self instead of abiding in Him. Because the God I serve says, and as I read earlier, come to me all you who are weak and heavy laden and I will give you rest. Does that mean it's not hard and it's not tough and it's not tiresome sometimes? No, absolutely not. But when we're abiding in Him, there's something beautiful that happens. I'll write back to God's thing. God claims us. God claims us. Look at verse 30. It's the word justified. The word justified is a good old Bible word, and every time you read it, we need to substitute this phrase. The word justified means just as if I had never sinned. The word justification is actually a legal term that means to be declared right, declared innocent, and declared guiltless. How many of us would say this morning, I know we don't like to put up our hands in here, how many of us would say, I'm righteous, you're righteous? How many of you would say that, I'm righteous? We kind of struggle with that word, don't we? I'm talking about the righteousness of Jesus. I'm not talking about self-righteousness. Jesus tells us that we have been justified, past tense, and we have been declared right before God. I love the way Billy Graham describes justification. He says, justification is the act of God whereby he declares an ungodly person to be perfect while he is still ungodly. God places you before himself as though you had never committed a sin. Charles Sturgeon put it this way, I'm so glad he chose me before he saw me, because if he had waited until he saw me, he might not have chosen me. God justifies us. We can, not with a unholy arrogance, but we can walk around going, I've been lifted from my burden of sin. That we don't have to walk around with the sting and the shame of going, well, if you only knew what I grew up in, or if you only knew what I had to go through. God does, and He's forgiven us from that, and He's given us a new life, and God will use that for His glory and for His honor. You see, the power of the gospel is incredible. That we don't have to let our past define us. You don't have to be who that last awful thing is that you did. That's not who you are as a follower of Jesus. And lastly, he completes us. God completes us. He finishes what he starts. If you look at verse 30 in the Bible, he uses the word glorified. Those of you who know the Bible know that we've not yet been glorified yet. Officially, we don't get glorified till we see Jesus one day. That's what happens when we die and we go to heaven and our bodies are changed to be more like Jesus. But I want us to look at how Romans chapter 30 tells that. He does it in the past tense. You say, well, wait a minute, isn't that incorrect grammar? Shouldn't it read, he called us, he justified us, and then he will glorify us? Why does it say he's already done it? Here's the great truth. In God's mind, he's not bound by time and space. It's a done deal. It's as if we've been glorified. God sees us as his child, that we're already there with him. And even though officially in our way of limited thinking, we haven't been glorified yet, in God's way of thinking, we have. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 says, our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly wait for a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. God says it's a done deal and it's going to happen. God has an incredible plan for our life. And at any point in this process, we can step off the plane and say, God, I don't want this anymore. But why would we want to? Why would we not want to be part of what God's plan is for us? God has an incredible plan for us. And he's given us the opportunity to step in to what that plan is. I'm going to play a song. Lori, I didn't tell you about this, but it is there ready to go right after my message notes. A brand new song that Mercy Me wrote that just came out a few days ago. And I love the words of this song talking about how God's plan is in place. And even though we can't see it and we don't feel like it right now, that God has predestined a plan for us that if we would step in and live the way that he's called us to live, that we could experience what it is that he has for us. We're not robots. We don't live as if we have no choice in what we're going to say and do and act and believe. That's not the way God operates. It's not the way the Bible operates. Otherwise, Jesus wouldn't have said, come and follow me. He wouldn't have given them a choice. They just would have came and followed him. You see what I'm saying? And so the choice is ours. Do you choose Jesus? He's already chosen us, but do you choose him in return to receive the gift that he has for us? As we listen to this song, before we break into our digging deeper groups, let these words sink into your heart and your life today. Let's go ahead, Lori.
Looking for a place to hide, not a lot of fight left in me. Who am I to even try? I can barely get to my feet. Still you stay beside me. Showing me that all my strength comes when I'm down on my knees. To how you work, yet you always do. Your heart beats for my good, so my heart beats for your good. Even when the storm is raging through, in the middle of it all, you prove your heart beats for my good, so my heart. This hurricane is nothing but a breeze to you. 'Cause I'm afraid that every wave's about to break this boat in two. Oh Lord, oh how I need you. Jesus. How you work, yet
Father God, this morning, thank you that you predestined a plan for us, spun it into motion before we were even thought about. And God, you want us to walk in that plan that you have for us. But Lord, we have to choose you. Lord, you've chosen us far long before we had the ability to be able to choose you, God. But God, help us to realize that you have an incredible plan for our lives. God, for those that are watching, those that are here that may be struggling with how you're working this plan out for your good and for your honor, God, I pray that you would give them the strength that they need. I pray that you would give them the comfort they need, that in the midst of their pain and sorrow and grief and struggle, that they would see, God, that when they keep their faith and their trust in you, Father, you'll never leave them alone. So God, help us to abide in you. To really abide in you. To lean on you. And not on our own understanding or knowledge or strength, but on yours. So that we could be who you've called us to be. And live the way that you've called us to live. Thank you for speaking to hearts and minds this morning. And we ask all of this in your name. Amen. Let's take 5 minutes and we'll dig into our digging deeper groups. Join us next Sunday. We're going to have a special service for our Remembrance Day Sunday service. We'll be glad to have you join us here. God bless you. Thanks for being with us today.